What is public key cryptography? Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. Before I dive into the topic, I want to be clear. This is an informational video, right? This is not something where you are going to end up needing to take action or change the way you do something. Public key cryptography is so fundamental to the way that the internet works today, and a few other things actually work today, that I wanted to basically provide you a bit of an overview at a conceptual level of exactly what it's all about and why it is so important, and honestly, why it's so cool. I do want to reiterate, this is a conceptual overview. This is not something where I'm going to dive into the details, the implementation details of public key cryptography. For one thing, they're way more complicated than even I am interested in diving into. I find it fascinating, but the specifics aren't really what matters here. What matters here are the concepts and why they are so important and so useful to what we do. When we think of encryption, it's usually the form of a tool like Zip. I'll just use Zip as the example. You can encrypt files using Zip by providing a password on the Zip command line or the Zip user interface. Then, when somebody needs to decrypt that Zip file, they need to provide the same password. That's called symmetric encryption. You use the same password to encrypt as you do to decrypt. It's probably the thing you are most familiar with because it's the thing we use the most often. In fact, for example, if you password protect a Word document, that's pretty much the same thing that's going on. It's encrypting the contents of the document, and in order to decrypt it, well, you need to provide the password that encrypted it. It's symmetrical, same at both ends. Now things get strange. The most important concept in public key cryptography, which is more correctly referred to as asymmetric cryptography, is simply this. There exist mathematical formulas that will produce two numbers. Those two numbers, which are very large, have two very, very interesting characteristics. The first is that you cannot use one to calculate the other. In other words, as far as you know, if you're given only those two numbers, or if you're given just one of those numbers, there's no way to figure out what the other number is. The second is that if you encrypt something with one number, it can only be decrypted using the other number. I'll say that again. If you've got two numbers, A and B, if you encrypt something using the number A, then you can only decrypt it using the number B. You can't even decrypt it using the number you encrypted it with, right? If you tried to, if you encrypt something with A, you cannot decrypt it with A. You must and can only decrypt it using the matching B. Now, typically, those are referred to as a pair of keys or key pairs. They are, in fact, encryption keys. They are asymmetric. You use a different number to encrypt than you do to decrypt. But it works in both ways. Anything encrypted with A can be decrypted with B, and anything encrypted with B can be decrypted with A. I know, it sounds almost fantastical. It's really some wonderfully magical mathematics behind it all. But like I said, it is the fundamental form of encryption that we're using, honestly, probably as you watch this video right now. So, asymmetric encryption. We kind of get that. A can encrypt and B can decrypt, and B can encrypt and A can decrypt. Great. What's this public thing? If you take those two numbers and treat them differently, then you enable a whole bunch of interesting things. By treating them differently, I mean simply this. We'll take one of the numbers and make it public. Literally give it to anyone. But keep the other number secret. So rather than referring to them as A and B, now we'll start to talk about them as the public key of the key pair and the secret key of the key pair. Why is this important? It enables two really interesting things. If I give you my public key for which I have the secret key, you can encrypt something using the public key that only I can decrypt. I'll say that again. You encrypt something with the public key, and because I have the secret key, and presumably only I have the secret key, that's why it's a secret, only I can decrypt the document. That means it's a great way for you to send me something securely. If you've got something that you want to make sure only I can see, the way to send it to me is to encrypt it using my public key and send it to me. Nobody else can see what's inside your document. Doesn't matter how you send it to me. You can send it to me by posting it on a bathroom wall if you need to. You can send it to me publicly. You can send it to me through plain email. The bottom line here is that if somebody were to intercept that and see the encrypted data, well, it's encrypted. They can't see what's inside. Only I can decrypt it because only I have the secret key. Okay, that's one of the two really interesting things that this enables. The other one is a little less obvious. It's identity verification. You probably didn't see that coming. Here's how it works. I create something, say a document, and I then encrypt it using my secret key. Anybody can decrypt it. This is not a means to protect the data. Anybody can decrypt it because my public key, the matching public key, is, well, public. So anything that I've encrypted using my secret key can be decrypted by anyone because they have access to my public key. But it does mean that if that decryption is successful, then that document could only have come from me, because only I have the secret key that would work with that public key. It's a form of identity verification. And in fact, it's pretty fundamental to a number of things. For example, it's part of what puts the S in HTTPS. Remember, so far, we've found that there are two things that are interesting about public key cryptography. You can use it to encrypt the data you're transmitting to somebody, and you can use it to verify that they are who they say they are. That's what HTTPS does. When a website sets up to support HTTPS connections, they generate, or purchase, or whatever, a pair of encryption keys. They keep one secret, literally secret, in a secure location on the website's server. The other one is basically registered in a public way so that not just anybody can say, you know, they've got the public key, say, for askleo.com. It has to come from a certain place. Anybody can see it, but it is registered in such a way that it is verified to be the public key for askleo.com. What that means then is that when you connect to askleo.com, the first thing that happens is your browser requests that askleo.com encrypt something using its secret key. Then, downloading that, your browser decrypts it. And if it was able to successfully decrypt it, then the browser knows for a fact that that server is in fact askleo.com, because it's just proven that it holds the secret key that matches the public key for the domain. Now, how about encrypting the data? Well, we've now established authenticity and authority, but the only way we can send data in this encrypted way is from the server to your browser. Once authenticity has been confirmed, that this is in fact the real askleo.com, then the browser basically generates a random number, a brand new encryption key that it then sends to the web server using this public-private or asymmetric encryption. So this secret key, this new, essentially random number, is transmitted completely securely using asymmetric encryption to the web server. Then, that's what they use to encrypt your data. It's an symmetric encryption key. Why? Well, the one thing I've kind of glossed over here is that, yes, asymmetric encryption is very interesting, very cool. It's got some wonderful properties, but it's computationally expensive. If at this point, the two ends of a conversation can agree on a simple symmetric encryption key that is generated on the spot, completely random and very long, then that becomes significantly easier for them to use to encrypt the data in both directions. The protocol, of course, is much more complicated than what I've outlined here. There are ways to ensure that the public key is correct. There are ways to ensure that the encryption key, the symmetric encryption key that they might be using along the way, could be changed throughout the conversation. There's a lot going on, but the fundamentals are all about public key encryption and letting the server hold a secret key. Everybody has the public key, and that then enables this bootstrapping of secure communications to your server. Now, the other thing that's kind of interesting, and one of the reasons that public key authentication is getting a little bit more visibility right now, is because of passkeys. I look at it as replacing something you know. Remember, basic authentication is something you know. You sign in with a user ID, which of course you know, and a password, which you know. You have proven that you know the password, therefore you must be who you say you are. Two-factor authentication adds to that something you have, so that when you sign in with your username, your password, something you know, and then you provide evidence that you actually have something else that was set up as the second factor, be it a code that proves you've got your smartphone, be it email code, be it something else, it doesn't really matter. In a way, this public key authentication can then be used to prove that you actually have a second factor, that you actually have something. At that point, you could almost jettison the something you know. In other words, it would be enough to sign in to just prove that you have an appropriate secret key. And that's honestly what passkeys are all about. In a separate article, I've discussed this, but the bottom line is that when you set up passkeys with an online service, you're setting up a public-private key pair. The private key is on your machine. It never leaves your machine, and only you have it. The public key is then stored by the service, but at the time when you sign in again later, the fact that you can prove you have the secret key by encrypting something that could only be decrypted by the matching public key proves you are who you say you are. You have the secret key, therefore you must be who you say you are. It is something that I think is going to be leveraged a lot in the future. I think passkeys are one of the things you've seen. This is also something that honestly is not new, right? Using this kind of public-private key authentication to identify yourself online is something that, well, some of us Linux users have been doing for years. Exactly the same thing. Passkeys basically just make that a little bit easier. So, like I said, there's really nothing to do based on all this information other than be comfortable with the technology. When passkeys come along, understand that's what they're doing. When you see HTTPS, okay, you've got a sense now for, yeah, there's some complicated encryption stuff going on that both verifies the identity of the site that I'm seeing and encrypts the data that's going back and forth between. I hope that helps. Hope at least found it interesting. For updates, for comments, for links related to this topic and more, visit askleo.com/158309. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is askleo.com. Thanks for watching.